Guess where I am again? Obviously, I just love it here. Food on a loop. Oh, it's so nice. It's quite filling. I'm really surprised how filling it is as well, because you think it's going to be expensive, but really, I mean, that is expensive. That's £3.50 for a few prawn crackers, so I'm never going to pick that up. But, yeah, it's very filling. And I think I'm full now, actually. I think Sir Sherlock is full as well. So good. But the thing is, though, you eat it, and then you look at these other things going around, you think, ooh, that looks nice. And what I like to do is not look and see where it is. I just like to just try it. And I really want to try that one now, but I'm full. I like the big triangle as well. So good. I'm salivating looking at it, but my belly's saying, you know you're full. Stop now. And your sushi has an outside area as well. And it's just down the side of Bond Street Station, down this alleyway. It's lovely. Opposite the Disney store is Boots, Big Boots, Boots! And that's where your sushi was, down there. And it just makes you so happy, because it's so fun, isn't it, Sherlock? Just having the food on a loop and eating as much or as little as you want. Keeping an eye on the price, but what we had there was £45 somewhat or other.
Yeah.
So it's not dear, because we're both full, and it's great.
Yep.
Isn't it funny how a failure can be so iconic? We're in Selfridges, darling. I'm just deciding to have an ogle in here. I'm going right to the top floor and working on my way down. And I saw these, oh, these tins, they're really nice. And yeah, it's dear, but do you know, they're in a lovely reusable tin. And I saw Cartwright and Butlev, England. All right, nice, nice, nice. And then I turn and read the back. Yorkshire, oh, from Yorkshire. And in Beverley, which is posh East Yorkshire. So the irony of where I'm from in Hull, you aspire to move to Beverley. And if I was to have bought these, I could have just saved dragging them up pretty much two-thirds up the way of the country, and I could just bought them from Beverley to take up north. That's so funny. It's almost the equivalent of going to France to buy some cooking pots and realising that, I don't know, they sell them in Selfridges. And yes, I do love biscuits. Look at that, that's a lovely tin. Don't remember when Cadbury's Roses and Quality Street used to be in tins.
Oh yes, yeah, collector's pieces.
Mm. Whereas nowadays they're in tiny plastic tubs. Just finding somewhere to sit down now and read the comments. There's a couple of crows there. Not quite a murder in Hyde Park, but... Oh, there's a butterfly. I probably can't see it. Oh look, horses! Aww. Oh.
I would speak to Sophie when you get back.
Yeah. Oh, more horses. Well, we've walked into Kensington Palace Gardens, which is always lovely. Still trying to find somewhere to sit down and do the comments. It is lovely here. I was only in Lidl yesterday and they had brambles, and how much was it? A punnet, something like £3 upon it.
Yeah, just
and they're just growing free. Growing free. You don't eat the green ones, you don't eat the red ones, you eat the black ones. I am tempted to try one, actually. Shall I?
Yes, I think you should.
I think I should. Can you take the bags off me, please? Cheers, thanks. Oh, gosh. I hate paper bags. I'm just going to... There we go. You got it. Right. I'm going to see. Oh, can I reach? Yes, I can. Just about. There we go. Look at that. And I'll spin it round. That's clean enough. It's not going to kill me. Oh, that's lovely. That's really nice.
You're growing horns out the top of your head now.
Oh, they're so sweet. I wishn't have done that. I want them all now. They're really good. I need a polarised lens to be able to see the fish properly, but... Oh! He made me jump! They're jumping out the water. I think you can sort of see them. I don't think I can put these fish in with the fish tank though, with scintillation and oscillation, or Cindy and Ozzy. I think these fish would eat them. Just a Rolls Royce ice cream van, as you do. Hello everybody, this is Sunday outside and we're in Kensington Palace Gardens because I thought that I would come to my own gardens because obviously I am the king. Anyway, Bodicea Revenge, oh, this is comments from last Sunday Outsiders, but I'm so happy that I've actually watched your Sunday Outside comments without adverts. Oh, deep, deep joy. Cheers, my dears. Looking forward to next videos. Look at you. Maybe the YouTuber algorithm decided not to show you any adverts. And Christine Morgan has put, the trick is not to fall into despair. Always look and see for beauty in everything, from a child's smile to the scent of a flowering tree. Well, I get air fever from trees. I get air fever from, well, not all the time, but when I do get air fever, it's usually earlier on in the year. I've just been talking about this, haven't we, Sherlock?
Yes, we both get hay fever. So.
But he gets it more and he gets it worse than me. But sometimes I get the odd nose twitch sometimes. London plane trees set me off. Walking through Chiswick High Street sets me off. Catherine Sinclair has put, I think the pink flower is hydrangea. I only know this because I have one too. Where did they see the hydrangeas? Oh yeah, in the garden at home. There was, I think, yes.
That's where they were.
The hydrangeas, I think, yeah, you're right. Tangled Charlotte's put, I'd love to hear some stories about you dealings with customers and co-workers in past jobs, unless it would be too traumatic. I spent one summer of my life in a pub facing job and haven't felt the same about humanity since. Especially when there's a football game on. And I did a whole series about places where I used to work, but I didn't really comment on customer interactions, did I? Because there's a whole because I've worked in so many places, there's a whole load of things that are still stuck in memory from, you know, working in shops, dealing with the public, and now some people in the public think that they own you just because you've come into the building that you happen to work in, and they think they somehow own you. It's like, no, no, you don't. This is not 1761. You've not walked into the Burlington Arcade in central London. You're not at flipping, what's it called? Fortnum and Mason, you know. Amandol. I suppose, watch some of your old videos. What happened to Miss Fly Tipper? You did make me laugh, however, I'd have stuck it outside the front door, but you were right in your view. You'd be fly tipping, so yes, that was a good couple of summers ago now. It was 2020 when that happened. And there was about a year or so later, I think it was. I think the brother actually did exist because he accosted me at the end of my street and went, oi. Well, he didn't say oi. But it was just saying, are you... He recognised me. I think he'd seen the video. And he got off his bike and walked towards me. And I just walked away. But you weren't going to do anything. I mean, it'd been stupid of him. I mean, I know his name. I know his address. But yeah, that's all that happened, really. And I do keep an eye on the same spot. Because every now and again, there is stuff thrown out on there. But nothing as disgusting as what that was. because that was just a line crossed. That was a straw too much. Kensington has put, you're doing slim fast to my too. My mum's doing that. Well, there was, but I fell off the slim fast wagon a couple of days ago. Even in this video, as you saw, I went to Your Sushi as well. But I am going back onto it next week. I've decided to have the weekend off from it. And there's a little horse fire that's landed on the tripod. Hello. I bet they can hear it. Oh, there's two of them. I bet they can hear it. You're on the wrong side of the camera. You need to be on this side. You need to be up here. Oh, never mind. And yes, that's Sunday outside. Let's move on
Lisa
to the next
Allen
interview.
And Emma Price of the Inquiry. Yes.
Ben 3 robot. Is that some out of Futurama? As well, if you ever have merch, Charlie, I want to see a hoodie with "Is that the truth or did you read it on a Horizon report?" Very funny. Yes, I know. Yeah, I should do a merch, shouldn't I? Really, but I just plod along, doing my own thing. I don't even do Patreon or anything like that. It's just me and you. So rare on YouTube these days, isn't it? Because they're always saying things like, "Before we get started, can you take the time to share, subscribe, and join me on Patreon?" Me. It's like, oh, shut up. Just do your video. Let me decide. Let me look you up. If you've got a Patreon or something. The Strat Picker has put, "So lamentable selection process and a series of crash courses. The feeling I get is that they were empowered headless chickens on a mission to find people guilty. The SPMs didn't stand a chance against this charade." I know, it's... everyone's just so right on this. Everyone's just so rightly outraged by the post office scam. And, yeah, I don't think I'd done a video before with Emma Price. As they think, I do a lot of videos with Jason Beer.
Yes,
as
you'll, he's yeah. A good laugh.
Yeah, it has good quips in this set and the other, don't he? Johnny Hi-Fi has put, "At 4 minutes and 35, first don't remember. Well done, Charlie, you beat me to it. I think there needs to be a bonus section, like a sweepstake multiplier on your Inquiry bingo card, based on the time till the first don't remember for a video. If it doesn't come for a long while, you should get more points overall. As the squares are probably going to fill up more slowly if they can contain themselves to say 10 minutes. The ones where the witness can't help themselves from their terrible Inquiry amnesia condition. It makes the bingo card just way too easy to fill up. And you should know it is if they blurt out, 'I can't remember,' within a couple of minutes or less." I know, yeah, I've not been putting the bingo card on the videos recently, have I? I totally forgot about it. And I did it for the Paul the Reynolds thing. And I'm sure someone's done a full house. But it takes a long time to make the videos. I mean, 8 hours or more to do 1 hour. But it's mad how long it takes to... How much time it takes to edit down a couple of minutes of video is mad. And then I've got to add my comments and edit out any bits where people are saying a bit too much or long pauses. It's amazing how much time you can edit out though, because each bit, let's say the original is almost 1 minute and a half, 1 hour and a half, an hour and a half, and I can take out a good 20 minutes usually, can't I? Neil Morrison's put, "The basic fact is the investigators were probably..." Pardon me. "Investigators were not properly trained, which is another management failing." I mean, yeah, bad training will go so far, absolutely. If you're not trained to do something, then you don't know what you're doing. But then there's also the person you are. There's your own self. And you must know somewhere in your mind if something doesn't sound right or if something sounds wrong, you think, hang on a minute. I mean, you do not have to be completely up to the hilt qualified to know that if someone's saying it's the computer system saying, hang on a minute, let's look that up. And more than just typing it in or making a phone call to, I don't know, Sandra in the people department of the post office. "All right, Sandra, love, is anyone else complaining about Horizon?" And just, I don't know, Sandra stuffing her face with her flipping Boots ready meal.
Oh, we've got a transistor radio to her.
And her Boots meal deal. And then she's like,
Oh, I don't know, Tracy. Just prosecute her anyway, mate.
I mean, that can't be too far off the actual truth of what happened, can it?
Sure, it's not. Just worrying.
Rosemary Clark has put, how could this lady possibly conduct an investigation? It's so scary. She was so dopey. She was stupid. And there's nothing wrong in calling people stupid if they've behaved stupidly. I don't see why that's a harsh thing to say. Some people need to be told you've been stupid more often, I think. I think we've entered a time where you can't say anything to anyone if it hurts their feelings. But sometimes, I think up north it's more usual to be...
I think you're more robust up north.
Yeah, I think you're more likely to be told, no, what you doing? What you doing, mate? Just, no. Whereas in the south and in London, I think you've all encouraged a bit too much. And in the US as well, in major cities.
Encouraged to be very PC
And it's just like, no, because sometimes I think you can be more PC by being a bit more forthright. Eugene McGiven has put, I don't recall the new famous get out of jail card. It is loosely translated as, I am lying. And I was like, could you just go to any old place and say, I don't recall? I mean, anyone could do a scam against the post office now, and you could just say, oh, I don't recall that. But we gave you money, don't recall it. I don't recall. And Mark Wilson has put, the incompetence of the post office management is on display for all to see. In the NHS, also poorly managed by such incompetence, probably. Everyone's got such great comments. I wish I had the time to read them all. They're all brilliant, they're all valid, they're all amazing. I do read all of them, and then Rinna read them out again on camera, because... It's nice to know, and it's quite nice to know that there is some sort of decency in the world. Part two of Lisa and Emma. Destiny One Productions has put, I was in court back in 83 doing jury service, and I can't remember anything after 41 years, except the cases, the defendants, the witnesses, the judges, and most of my fellow jury members. Yes, because Lisa said she couldn't remember going to court. She couldn't remember going to court for 3 days.
Yes.
She couldn't remember to go into court to give evidence. She forgot all that.
Just gone completely, yeah.
Just gone, I mean...
Maybe it automatically sort of went...
Who knows? I can still remember going to do jury service. This will have been about 20-odd years ago now. And I can still remember, I mean, all the cases, the criminals kept pleading guilty. So I didn't actually get to go into the courtroom. And we was all released at the end of the week. And it was incredibly boring, but I still remember it. And usually you forget boring stuff, don't you? Pretty much.
Well, you just reminded me I did jury service, but if you hadn't mentioned it now, I wouldn't remember.
Exactly, and then the more you think about it, you think, actually, yeah, then I did this, did that, did this. And that's what you do. But I can't even fathom to think how someone can not only forget going to court, but giving evidence in a court. How many times... have you got to do that to forget it?
Well, you might be traumatised by the court's experience.
Well, yeah, she was traumatised by the amount of money should have been given to go. Because you get given money to go. Because
yes.
It goes up in stages. If you, if it's just general, moron has done some vandalism, this, that and the other, you get your normal pay, what you would normally get at work. But if it goes on to something like a murder or some like really big fraud case or something, that's when the really big money starts rolling in, because they're inconveniencing your life. You know, they put you in a hotel, they give you money for food and everything like that. All I got was just the standard basic stuff. And you got given this little card. See how much I remember? I got given this little white card, and it gave you a credit to buy food from the canteen because you had to stay in the court, you couldn't leave. And the sandwiches were the most tasteless, sponge-like bread you can think of, with the slitheriest of fillings. I thought you were skin flints. And then there was like these rock-hard biscuit things on a white plate. And it was just like... So the credit was worthless. So everyone started bringing their own food. The magazines, there were stacks of magazines in this big table, and it was all ancient. Nobody was flicking through them. There was just dumped on there. And I remember it was when Beckham and Victoria Beckham and David Beckham getting married. It's like, flipping heck, how long he's been on here? I can remember all that. Martin Ward has put, Price and beer are the same person. Fabulous how their delivery is consistent. Emma Price is really good, and it's a bit annoying that I haven't shown her as much on my edited down videos, because she is so precise, and there is very few M's coming out of Emma. She's really just, it's almost like Mr. Beer has read through it word for word, and it's all up here, and it seems to stay there, and it's just amazing. They're really talented people. Poppycat has put, she cannot remember going to court because she didn't then, and doesn't now care at all about the SPMs. Like all the post office investigators, she is a liar, and she should be removed from her job with Royal Mail Group immediately. Oh yeah, she's still working for Royal Mail, yeah. She surely has no credibility to perform it. Same should happen to all those who are still employed by post office and Royal Mail Group. Yeah, and they'll all keep saying, oh, but they can't get rid of all the staff. It sounds massively overstaffed already. They all need to go. Mike Ferguson has put, apparently one of the requirements for employment at post office was a lack of a functioning memory. You see, I've got a really bad memory. Maybe I should go work for the post office.
No, I should, because I've got non-existent memory.
There we are. Me and Cheryl could go off to work for the post office. And what's great is, even if they watch this, they'll forget about it. They won't be able to recall it. So we'll get the job. Yeah. That's just it. You just keep applying. And you can just say, no, I've not had an interview with you before. I don't recall an interview with you before. At 2503D, Deborah has put, the whole company acted like a nest of vipers. Yeah, but at least vipers have a point, you know? At least they eat rats. And Jim Hornsby has put, no memory of this woman. How did she get the job? I don't recall. I don't know who she is. Whose hands are these? Helen Black, liar, liar, liar. Yeah. It's just true. Shed boy, why don't these barristers say you're under oath a few times? They know the lie. Yeah, that's a point, though, because sometimes I think they prefer them to keep speaking, because so often they can lead themselves down the cul-de-sac before Emma and Mr. Beer... What? Emma Price. Miss Price and Mr. Beer lead them down that cul-de-sac. Let them talk themselves into it. Because they clearly don't have a brain, these witnesses. So they might lead themselves down a cul-de-sac they can't get rid of. And it just happened a few times, because Mr. Beer did say, and it was with Elaine Cotton. She was rambling on, trying to say that the sub-post mistress's husband was working in the post office, which was a so what? Because Mr. Beer was like, and your point is, and your point is, and your point is, isn't it? Three times. And she was like, it doesn't matter. I don't want to go there. And then Mr. Beer said, I think you just did. It's so funny. Shed boy put, go Emma girl. And Paul Gerard has put, horrible piece of work. I hope her family are proud of her. This is what's quite interesting. All the friends and family of these people, what are they thinking? My nose is tickling, by the way. I'm either ready for a fight or I'm near a tree that's pollinating and making my nose itch. But yeah, what do all the friends and family think of all these people at the post office scandal? I mean, can you imagine being related or being friends with one of these people who has put innocent people in prison? It's outrageous. There was a bit of a change from the post office stuff. And it was the Microsoft CrowdStrike crash that crashed practically nearly the whole world of their computer systems. Didn't affect me at all. And loads of people saying it didn't affect them, but I think it mainly affected big companies more than the public. I think it was mainly a systems thing. Maybe it affected you indirectly, like it might have affected your bank. For instance, it affected my bank, but it didn't affect me, if you know what I'm saying. It didn't affect my computers or anything like that. Nothing too much. I know loads of people were affected with flights. That's how it would have affected you more, because you might have been in a strange country somewhere trying to get away or to it.
Cash machines were affected.
Cash machines were affected. It just proves you need to carry cash.
A whole lot of things.
Yeah. You need to carry cash. I think you should keep at least maybe about 50 quid in your house, just in case of these emergencies, because Co-op suffered as well. But I didn't go to Co-op for a couple of days. So we haven't been to Co-op for about a week now, have we? So it didn't affect us.
Then wouldn't you have the problem if you got the cash with you? You go to the shop,
they can't necessarily process it because
Because the tills aren't working. But they were still taking cash, a lot of them. Waitrose was taking cash, apparently. And I've worked for places that had gone to card only, and it is stupid because they never kept even a reserve. You'd think that they would have kept the safe and kept a small reserve when the systems go down, because systems are fallible. But anyway, Val Rogers has put, completely passed me by head, nothing about it until 6 p.m. news. Yeah, I mean, it was a big thing, and I think the reason why it was such a big thing is because it did affect the media. Sky News crashed, didn't it? And BBC had a few channels go off as well. It was easy pickings for the media to latch onto. User 3137 has put, even train stations showed the blue screen of death. Airports, particularly Indian airports, showed it as well. TV broadcasters were affected and everything. People still had to go into work yesterday, even if they were ill. Yes, we are in a world where technology is a complete necessity of life.
Which it is nowadays.
It is.
Unless you live in outer Mongolia or
somewhere really random, like you just live in a hut, something, which hardly anyone does anymore. And so the video was about me being annoyed about, because the irony of all the old people, like in the comment section of the newspapers, moaning that all you youngsters are just too dependent on technology. It's like, well, hang on a minute, you're commenting on the Daily Mail or the Mirror comment section. Aren't you doing exactly the same thing to voice your opinion? It made no sense. You know, by rights, shouldn't you be writing on a piece of paper and posting it off into a letterbox? It's ridiculous. Probably you don't want to anyway. Red Pillar 6050 has put, more proof that Microsoft isn't the best anymore. It was, I think it was the CrowdStrike thing, but even then, you'd have thought that Microsoft would have had some more things in place.
I'm not even sure Microsoft were ever the best, because lots of other companies have other systems. Microsoft just happened to be one of them. So
I've never rated Microsoft.
When you get in the professional marketplace, I mean, Microsoft perhaps isn't considered as. You've got Linux and Unix and various other things.
And Safari's on Apple, Apple. And whatnot, yeah. And I've never rated Microsoft. Microsoft just seems to buy companies and ruin them. Look what it did to Nokia. And look, it might buy companies that are already struggling, but then do nothing with them, then just bin them off. Look what happened to Skype. How many times have they tried launching video phone sort of things? What was it, Microsoft Teams? And that's it. You don't hear anyone talk about Microsoft Teams anymore, do you? There's loads of other examples and I can't think of any right now. Microsoft buys, ruins, and then just moves on. It's like the Amazon of the business computer world, Microsoft. You wonder how it keeps going, but it somehow seems to keep going. Dominic AAA here has put, saw a woman on the news earlier. She was like, well, I've hardly got any food in. I was going to do a shop today, and now what will I do? I'm going to have to try and find the cash from somewhere. Doesn't every supermarket have an ATM outside, lol? I'm presuming this 75-year-old woman was going to pay with a debit card, not a built-in microchip in her eyeball. So it's not a massive hardship to draw cash out, is it? I know, because not all the cash machines went down. Just seemed like a bit of a silly thing to moan about. Well, the media will always find the nearest fool to go on camera. Some people seem to feel entitled, don't they, and expect that everything is going to work at all times, and if not, they aren't having it. The woman isn't going to starve waiting another day to go to a shop. There's loads of other shops, isn't there? You don't have to go to a supermarket. You can go to your little corner shop that still have something into it. You're not going to starve. This woman isn't going to starve waiting another day to go to the shop. Not that she seemed too annoyed, to be fair. But the other month, I was in A&E and there were two people behind me fuming that it was taking ages to get seen. Oh, I had that when I went to the doctor about my eye. You know, when my eye went really funny that time. And there was this woman and everyone was in there and everyone had eye problems, obviously. It was at the eye hospital. And this one woman just wouldn't shut up. And do you know what? To look at her, you wouldn't think there was anything wrong with her. And everyone else was there, like they'd spilt stuff in their eye or something. And I had my weird eye infection I'd got from somewhere. And it's never been completely right since. And I swear it's something to do with the Wahoo flu, because it's when I got it. And there were people in there with genuine problems. And this one woman, she just wouldn't shut up. And it was annoying because everyone else has been lovely and silent because, you know, the British being all like patient and they sat on the other. It was fine. We was waiting a very long time, hours and hours, but it's free. It's the NHS, you know. And there are some people in there thinking, hang on a minute, you could have just gone to the chemist first. You could have probably got some eye drops to sort that out. It's probably just hay fever or something. But there was generally people in there with problems. But this one woman, I think the louder they're kicking up a fuss, because otherwise she would have gone to A&E. They wouldn't have diverted her to the eye hospital. So it can't have been that bad. Anyway, I don't know what my point is really with this comment. I suppose it's just that people should try to be a bit more understanding sometimes and to appreciate things, not just moan. We all have to deal with S luck sometimes, don't we? And as rubbish a lot of politicians might be, most of us are lucky to be in the UK where things are generally all right. I know, yeah. I mean, I think people find it easy to bash the UK just because it's so good. So, I mean, I am so glad I am not in America because I would dread to think how much this eye would have cost me financially. I mean, I had to get some prescription eye drops a couple of times and I was fine. But if it was America, I'd have been charged a fortune for it. You get charged to see the doctor, you get charged, then I would, because I had to go to the doctor first, then he had to go to the eye hospital, then he had to see a proper eye doctor. Then I got to see somebody else there. I think I saw about 3 or 4 people before I got diagnosed with whatever it was and given some proper good eye drops. And then I probably would have been charged a lot more at the pharmacy in the hospital. Because I didn't just go to Boots. You had to go to the pharmacy in the hospital. So, yeah. What, you was going to say something?
No, that's fine.
Late night comment because it's boiling. Oh, I want it just. high 20s. Like the heat wave the other year was just awful. Jealous of your AC, hope it is on tonight. I love my air conditioning unit, it's so good. I can't believe I've waited so long. I've still not proper sorted out the window arrangement yet. I am gonna have to get it done. I put a lot of masking tape up, where it all just tore off because the air conditioning unit creates suction in the room, so the door wouldn't shut. So when I shut the door, the air got sucked in and it ripped all the air masking tape off and it just ravved it right off. And I was like, oh, what a waste of time. But I'll have to make something a bit more permanent. But yeah, you've got to get aircon. If you can't stand the heat as much as I can't stand the heat, get aircon. It's brilliant. Stuff the environment. I want to stay in some sort of ability to keep working and alive in the heat. So there. Dilco Studios has put, I want more tipping point. I haven't done a tipping point video for ages. Amanda All has put, yes, I wonder who was involved. Two countries, no doubt, are suspected. Your video is the light relief after the vast amount of evidence from Jo Swinson. I feel like I've run a marathon listening. She talked for Britain. I didn't watch the Jo Swinson thing, but I did watch Dame Moya Green. And I had no idea she was Canadian. It was really weird listening to her. She sounded like a strange collaboration of a horrible version of Betty White. And a bit like Meryl Streep, but played a horrible character. So I might do a recording of her. I might edit her rubbish down. She was weird. David McDonnell. Yes, this is the bloke who worked at ICL, which is owned by Fujitsu. It's all called Fujitsu now. And he was just spilling all facts and saying exactly what was happening in the creation of the Horizon system, especially on the EPOS system, which is electronic point of sale. And back then, obviously, Post Office Limited was called Post Office Counters Limited. So it was called POCL for short. And it was, yes! Steve Hill has put, this guy is seriously off script, about 10 exclamation marks. I can't hear him say, I don't recall, I have no recollection, I don't remember, 4 exclamation marks. Well done, sir. Exactly, he was just saying exactly the problems, what was happening in his computer system, and nobody was listening to him. He wanted to rewrite the cash account system. The main part, financial stuff, for the post office counters, what some postmasters was going to use, and they just didn't listen to him.
What was his name?
McDonnell.
Okay.
David McDonnell. And PA1189. Oh, yes, who alerted me to him. Thank you so much. Because this bloke, for some reason, just passed me by. Has put, thanks for covering this. He really does lift the covers and show what was happening underneath. In part 2, it should show that he sacrificed his own his own prospects by refusing to agree to Fujitsu demands. Absolutely. He put his job prospects on the line and suffered because he was trying to get this cash account part of the Horizon system rewritten, because it was in full of bugs. That it wasn't just full of bugs. The code that was written was so ridiculous. It was, as McDonnell says, it was written by somebody who didn't even grasp elementary level mathematics. Yeah. It was, they just didn't even know how to write code, and they were just writing bilge. And it was all just floating around in the system because they never deleted it. So who knows what problems it caused. Matthew Wackett has put, thanks for resurrecting this very important representation. It needs to be seen to put in the subsequent process of 2024 into context. They all knew, management, post office, Fujitsu and the government. They all knew. They all knew. And for them to be saying, oh, I can't recall, it's... It just, my passion for exposing and making sure that as many people know about this post office fiasco scam scandal as much as possible, and I'm really glad so many people are watching it, has just been bolstered by this, because it just shows you how incompetent and stupid and irritating it is that these people will get paid vast sums of money to lie, to make rubbish and to cause so much pain and suffering. The Observer has put, Mr. McDonnell is refreshingly forthright and direct in his responses with a great memory. His statements are clear and very illuminating regarding the shoddy staff and substandard capabilities of many of those involved who are culpable and irresponsible as they played their part in this outrageous miscarriage of justice. Exactly. He barely said, I don't recall or I don't remember, but you knew the bits that he didn't remember was logical things that you wouldn't remember or if you weren't involved in at all. You could tell it was all truth that he was speaking. And because this happened 2 years ago, the media have not covered anything about this bloke. And it just has to ask more questions, though. I was thinking, I wonder if he spoke to Sir Alan Bates. Did he speak to? Did Mr. Bates even know that this bloke existed? Do you know, where did he go? Michael Enright has put, somebody who can remember not obfuscating. I can't say that word. It was too long ago. Is a good honourable man, absolutely. Mr. SCPC has put, I missed this earlier and I'm so appreciative of the opportunity to see it now. I've watched everything you've done with gratitude and horror. I don't actually know who you are or why you care enough to make all this effort, but thank you so much for your great work. Thank you very much. There's so many reasons why I've done it. There's so many reasons. Not just the miscarriage of justice, not just because of the victims, but it's the business side as well. I'm very interested in business, and I'm very interested in companies when they do right and when they do wrong, and opportunities what they could do. So this just ticks so many boxes for me of why I'm so passionate about this. Robert Newton has put, how refreshing to listen to clearer answers and to questions without any fudging. Coding is a very topical issue at the moment. This evidence does not reflect well on Fujitsu. Absolutely. Fujitsu sent their own staff from Japan to go and see what's going on, and they did nothing. They just cleared off and went back to Japan. David BK8BY has put, funny how he can recall detailed stuff back then, but everyone else can't recall anything at all, even basic stuff. Absolutely, absolutely. Well, it's like, what does Judge Judy say? To lie, you don't particularly need a good... to lie, you need a good memory, but to tell the truth, you don't need a good memory. Yeah, so... James Bowie has put, great work, Charlie. Thanks, thank you very much. Let me know, is it Bowie or Bowie? Mark Foster's put, an honest account of his recollection. Well done, sir. He obviously sidesteps the Alzheimer's cluster that those at the post office and law firm seem to have landed themselves in and been infected by. Exactly. I mean, obviously loads of it is on the post office and Fujitsu, but obviously there's Cartwright, King and Bond Dickinson. Womble Bond Dickinson. Womble Bond Dickinson.
I always thought that was a peculiar name.
I know, yeah. And it's funny, because Wombles are meant to be picking up litter that ordinary people leave behind, whereas just Womble Bond Dickinson is like the complete opposite. Just, like, just makes loads of rubbish and leaves everywhere for people to pick at. A few more comments, because there's just so many. Ben Wilson has put, an amazing man never caught Alzheimer's, even though it was prevalent. I know, yeah, I mean, a fly attacking me now. It's one of them horse flies again, isn't it? Oh, I am. Barry Heath has put, parachute regiment tie, respect. use a PM2007Z7J has put, at last a truth teller. There's so many good comments. Thank you, everyone, for being interested in the inquiry, the scam, the scandal. Thanks for paying attention to it.
Small dog, big voice.
It's always the small dogs that make the most irritating noise, isn't it? And it's barking at a dog that's about four times the size of the other dog. Stupid. I can't stand yapping little dogs like that. I like big dogs. I like big dogs. Those, oh. You know, when you get home, dogs that can greet you rather than just like nibble at your ankles. And yeah, next video two of McDonnell. Adopt a greyhound. Oh, that's put, what a breath of fresh air, someone actually answering the questions without talking in time-wasting circles or waffling on and telling nothing but lies. I'm glad you found this, Charlie. Great that I'd completely missed it. Well, yeah, I'd missed it as well. It was because of one of you, the viewers, that found it and noted it to me. Thank you so much. Because it's clearly been lost to history. And I'm glad that it was alerted to me because I've brought it back after 2 years. Paul Oldfield has put, Jason B deserves huge recognition and thanks from every one of us. His patience throughout this inquiry has been exemplary. Absolutely. I hope you all get some kind of good award or notification or something, because they've all worked really well.
I was going to say the whole team have been really good.
They really have, yeah. All of them. Mr. Stevens and Mr. Blake, Miss Price, Antonia, I've forgotten her last name. Mr. Beer, and yes, all of them I've seen. They've
all
been so
like
good.
Family now, don't they?
I know, yeah. I haven't seen them that much. Mark Foster's put, of all the people I have watched in this inquiry, he has come across as the most professional and honest. Much respect, David. Absolutely. I mean, your comments are so good, because it just shows that there's all of us, there's enough good still left in the world, just outraged by this scam. Hesim has put, as a former software developer, these revelations are just pitiful. It is a recipe for disaster. Well, that recipe was made, prepared, cooked and eaten by the post office, and it's just, it's all there. All the ingredients of idiocy. Matthew Wacker has put, again, thank you for resurrecting this crucial material. Without seeing this, one can be unsure of post office management for Jitsu. Yes. Seeing this is no doubt that the powers that be were all fully aware of the failed system from the very beginning. It was all there. It was all there, and it's just been allowed to grow and grow and grow. But as in revenge, I wonder if the info of this testimony was the precursor to Richard Rule's statement about the remote backdoor entry into Horizon. Yeah, nothing much was mentioned on that. I hope they bring back David McDonnell. That'd be really interesting if they brought him back to the inquiry for anything he's heard, or if he's remembered anything else, or ask him some new questions. Because all this backdoor entry to the system, he must have known about all this as that and the other, but he wouldn't ask them questions because it wasn't that part of the inquiry. Michael Enright has put, this opens for Jitsu to massive lawsuits and to repay the government for losses and the sub-postmasters. User 3137C6F has put, as for Emma Price, imagine that Emma Price and Jason Beer edited down video. Emma would say to Jason, what is the price of beer? loads of people, obviously, as well, giving great thanks to the people at the inquiry asking the questions, Mr. Beer, Miss Price, Mr. Blake, Mr. Stevens. I can't remember Antonia's last name. Never mind. I don't think I've done any videos with her. Robert Wright has put, hey, wait a minute, this guy can remember stuff. I know. It's shocking, isn't it? Because every time you turn on one of these people on the inquiry, they're like, can't recall. If he was to take a shot of a drink every time you were, I can't remember, I don't know, it was such a long time ago. I mean, people die. And then there's people that have to be done for, like, murder because it'd be their fault. Leslie Collins says, but yes, another British company at the time, CIG, now BOC. I refused to put the data in for 2 days later and they asked me to fix it. I said, whoever put it in, fix it, not me. Haha. It took them 3 days. We had over 700,000 account. Haha. I did ask in the video, didn't I, about people, if you've ever worked somewhere and you saw something that was completely wrong and you was telling your bosses or you was telling your work colleagues, look, this is wrong. This has got to stop. We've got to change something. We've got to say something. Or you do say something and you are just browbeaten down by your management. It's happened to me a few times. It's happened to me at Argos and it happened to me at Iceland and one or two other times as well by saying, look, this is wrong. Hotel Chocolat, I even mentioned it to you, didn't I, when I worked at Hotel Chocolate, as I like to call it. Now taken over by Mars, which sorts of take the quality of away from it, doesn't it? When we all knew that this inbox promotion was going to be a disaster, all of us in the shop were saying, no, this is going to stop people from buying the chocolate from the shop. They're just going to stay at home and order it online. I mean, you've just opened up all these shops. It's going to be a mistake. Why are we doing it? This and area manager and the manager were saying, no, this is what we're going for. But even the manager, she was like, it's not great, is it? It's like, well, no, it isn't. Can't you say something? Then all the inbox chocolates got delivered as a promotion for this subscription service to Hotel Chocolat. The t-shirts for the staff arrived. All the POS arrived to be put up. And on the day of launch, cancelled. What a waste of money. All the effort and the time and the printing and the making of the t-shirts and the special boxes made of chocolates and everything. All for nothing. And then for 2 or 3 weeks... I can't remember if you remember me telling you about this, but for about 2 or 3 weeks, these big boxes of chocolate giveaways we was meant to be given were stuck in the stock room, not going in anywhere, to the point the chocolates were about to go past the best before date. And, we just ended up eating them. Because there was cost of stock, but they were free. So we was never getting a response back of what was meant to do with these chocolates. So we just started picking a box off every now and again, and we just wrote it down how many we had, and we just wrote them off as loss. It was a complete waste of time and effort. And it just shows that when the people at the top do not listen to the people at the bottom, you know, the people at the bottom might be working for you, but they still have the ideas. They still know what the customer wants and they still know they want to keep the job. So if it's too heavy at the top and they're too browbeating you down, how many companies have gone bust because they've not listened to the staff at the bottom? I bet it's millions across the world, isn't it? But it could be a very big number because you've got to listen to your staff at the bottom and not in a patronising way. And because I know the current CEO of Morrison's, he likes to go to the shops. And unfortunately, the people who gravitate towards these upper management people are the proper kissy of the bottom people, aren't they? Who you really... because they're just trying to climb up the company in whatever means possible. And they'll say, oh, yes, sir, no, sir, 3 bags full, sir. And you're thinking, oh, you're so cringeworthy. It used to happen. Hotel Chocolat, Hotel Chocolate. What's his face who used to earn it before he flogged it to Mars? He used to come into the shops. What was his name? Not Douglas. What was his flipping name anyway? Unimportant. And no one's watching probably with this length of the video anyway, so I'm going to say thanks for watching anyway. But oh yeah, the kissy bummy people I used to work with in companies, when people from head office used to come in and thinking, oh, just shut up. Do you know what I mean? You felt like handing them a roll of bloody toilet roll, you know what I'm saying? It's, hey, your breath stinks. Anyway, that's quite a good bitchy thing to say, isn't it?
You've let it all out, man.
I've let it all out. Thanks for watching, everyone, and I'll see you when I see you. Scrabs, bye.
Bye.
That's what was behind me, by the way. I've put it in the vertical because if I do that, I'll never get it all in.